Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak today. So when I first thought about what I should be speaking about on the ways to improve effectiveness of colorectal cancer screening, I had two different options. To speak about emerging or future colorectal cancer screening tests, including new imaging techniques, genetic genomic profiling, or use of biomarkers, which may change the future and change the effectiveness of colorectal cancer screening, but there is no good data on that currently. And this is only a future and some promising tests. So the focus of my lecture would be to focus on available colorectal cancer screening tests, and you heard that these are the non-invasive screening tests like annual FOBT or FIT, stool DNA testing, and also some more invasive or endoscopy screening like sigmoidoscopy every 5 years or once in a lifetime, and colonoscopy every 10 years or once in a lifetime. So first of all, we have to ask ourselves, what is the effectiveness? So the definition of effectiveness of colorectal cancer screening, it's ability to reduce colorectal cancer incidence and mortality in population. Therefore, one of the most critical determinants of effectiveness of colorectal cancer screening is compliance, which means that the population adheres to colorectal cancer screening. The other key factor is the efficacy of the screening test, which allows a high detection rates for adenomas and cancers. Then something which is tightly associated with efficacy, which is a quality of screening test and also diagnostic evaluation, which is primarily a colonoscopy, and then the quality of treatment for screen-detected lesions. Therefore, I would like to tackle and speak about how to improve these four major determinants, starting with compliance. You already heard a little bit about it. And we know that compliance with colorectal cancer screening is highly variable across countries and programs, ranging from 10 to even 90%. But I want also to highlight that compliance with colorectal cancer screening, although it's unsatisfactory in many countries, it can be good, as shown on these graphs from the US. And what you can see here that of the entire target population in the United States aged 50 to 74 years, 2/3 of people are up to date with colorectal cancer screening, and additional 7% have had screening in the past but are not up to date. And of all those, 85% of those people choose colonoscopy as their screening option. Therefore, even if with such an invasive test as colonoscopy, you can achieve like a 60% participation rate in population. So what can we do to increase, to promote compliance with colorectal cancer screening? There is lots of data about it, so I will focus only on those most important interventions. And you can intervene on three levels: on the policy level, on the provider level, and on the patient level. So let's start with the policy level. The most effective intervention that you can establish, and you already heard about it from our Czech friends, is to implement organized program, which means that you reduce financial barriers because the test is usually free of charge for participants. You have active invitation of entire target population. You have reminders to non-responders, and you have also follow-up of screen positive results well set up. And these are very well-known interventions to promote compliance with colorectal cancer screening. The other thing that you have to consider on the policy level is the choice of the screening test. And here you have these four screening options and the summary of participation rate provided to us by the World Gastroenterology Organization. And in general, it is believed that non-invasive tests have higher compliance or yield higher compliance than invasive tests. But what you can see here that this compliance is highly variable, and it can be good even with invasive tests, and it cannot be, and in some occasions it can be really poor with non-invasive tests as well. But I want to focus your attention also on this study. This is a randomized controlled trial from the United States with three arms. So the participants were randomly assigned either to FOBT arm, colonoscopy arm, or a choice arm between FOBT and colonoscopy. And what is very interesting here that with giving a choice to people, you may increase your participation as compared to, for example, colonoscopy arm without losing people who comply with colonoscopy. So more or less you have the participation rate to colonoscopy screening at the same range as offering only colonoscopy, but on top of it you can have additional participation to FOBT screening. Therefore we should probably not close our minds to this different options and offering people a choice, because for some invasive is fine and for some they prefer a non-invasive test. So on the provider level, the most important intervention is involvement of the primary care physician or involvement of a primary care provider. And I want to illustrate it with the study that was done in Poland together with our general practitioners. And this was a randomized controlled trial of 600 consecutive patients who were referred to general practitioners, and they were assigned either to receive only informational leaflet about colorectal cancer screening or to receive active counseling about colorectal cancer screening. And what you can see that compliance with screening colonoscopy was 14% with informational leaflet, but almost 50% with active counseling. This shows the magnitude of effect of general practitioner in those terms. What is also interesting here, that the compliance with unsedated colonoscopy was significantly higher when physicians, general practitioners, actively counseled their patients to undergo colonoscopy. And the third level is a participant level, and the most important thing is to increase individual awareness. This is probably the most difficult issue, but there are some options to raise awareness. And these include informational or enhanced leaflets, advanced notification letters, promotional campaigns. Although we believe that this is very successful, it has limited impact, we have to say, but still it's effective. And also something which is to be considered is active patient navigation, therefore how to help patients to make their appointment for a screening test. So these are interventions that can promote compliance with colorectal cancer screening on a participant level. So let's move to the efficacy of the test and how can we choose or improve it. So this is a summary of efficacy of available colorectal cancer screening tests, and what you can see here that for endoscopy screening, both colonoscopy and flexible sigmoidoscopy, it has high sensitivity both for advanced neoplasia and cancers, whereas non-invasive tests, they are reasonably sensitive for colorectal cancer, and you repeat them every 1 year or every 2 years, but they are unsatisfactory in terms of detection of advanced neoplasia or precursor lesions. And this brings us to some kind of decision what we want to achieve with colorectal cancer screening, because indeed, these non-invasive tests are mostly early detection tests. Therefore, you will achieve only reduction in colorectal cancer mortality in your population, whereas if you implement endoscopy screening, which allows both colorectal cancer prevention and early detection, you may reduce colorectal cancer mortality and reduce colorectal cancer incidence in the same time. So you've seen that the sensitivity for detection of advanced neoplasia and cancer is variable, and this diverse sensitivity is tightly associated with the quality of the examination. And I want to illustrate it by discussing these things on detection of precursor or adenomatous lesions in the colon. You are probably familiar with the quality indicator, which is known as adenoma detection rate. It is the rate in which, or the percentage of patients in which you detect at least one adenomatous lesion. And on this graph, you can see variability in adenoma detection rate by endoscopists in the early years of our program in Poland. These are 126 colonoscopists who performed at least 30 colonoscopies within our program. And what you can see is that adenoma detection rate varied from 1.7% to 37% at that time, which means a 20-fold difference. Does it matter? Yes, it matters. So this graph shows the cumulative hazard rates for interval colorectal cancer according to endoscopist adenoma detection rate. And the interval cancer is a cancer that occurs despite or negative colonoscopy. And what you can see here on this graph, this yellow line shows the risk of interval cancer in patients who were examined by endoscopists with adenoma detection rate of at least 20%, whereas all these colorful lines show you the risk of interval cancer if the patients were examined by endoscopies with lower adenoma detection rates. And this difference is a tenfold difference in interval cancer risk. These results were confirmed in a second study, a study by Doug Corley, and they were even extended to the colorectal cancer mortality or fatal colorectal cancer, and you can see that with increasing adenoma detection rate, the chance of dying from cancer drops. So is there any way to address this question and improve the quality? Yes, there is. And you can achieve it even with simple monitoring and giving feedback to the patients. And these are the graphs from our colorectal cancer screening program from the years 2004 to 2008. We started with overall adenoma detection rate of around 14%, and in the year 2008, we achieved already 20% average adenoma detection rate. This means 1.5 percentage point increase per year. And this adenoma detection rate is constantly rising. But if you want to be even more effective, you can also offer some additional training to your endoscopists. And what we did in this study, this was a very big randomized controlled trial involving over 50,000 screening participants. And in this trial, we compared the effect of training the leaders of, or usually the chiefs of screening centers, and compared it with the feedback only, monitoring and feedback. And we measured the effect on both leaders and centers' performance in terms of adenoma detection rate, proximal adenoma detection rate, and flat polyp detection rate. And what you can see here is that on the left panel, you have the effect in the feedback group. On the right side, you have the effect in the train the colonoscopy leaders group, and after 1 year, the increase in adenoma detection rate was higher in the train the colonoscopy leaders group, and there was a sustained effect even the year after when the intervention already stopped, and these were highly statistically significant difference between these two options. Therefore, we really can change the quality of endoscopy. And Is it matter? Yes, it matters, because this graph shows whether improvement helps to decrease the risk of colorectal cancer. And you can see here that endoscopies, or patients who were examined by endoscopists, who did not improve over time, did not improve their adenoma detection rate over time, their risk of having interval cancer remained stable. Whereas patients examined by endoscopists who improved their adenoma detection rate over time had really significantly reduced risk of having interval cancer. But it's not only about the quality of colonoscopy itself, but you can also have some variations in the quality of non-invasive tests, and it has already been mentioned that there is some influence of seasonal variations in ambient temperatures on performance of FIT, and what you can see here is the drop in the mean concentration of hemoglobin with the rise of temperature. Therefore, you have to address it if you want to have an effective screening program using non-invasive tests. And the very last part is about how to improve treatment. I will not be speaking about treatment of cancers, but we treat polyps. And we also know that there is variable quality of polyp removal by endoscopists, as shown in this landmark study by Heiko Pohl. And what you can see here, this is the data from one academic center in the United States showing the incomplete resection rate among five different experienced gastroenterologists. And it ranged from 7% to over 20%, which means over threefold difference. Can we do something with that? There is no very good evidence, but we know that we have to focus better on margins assessment and on in-black resection, and all that can be probably achieved with additional training. And there are also some new training tools developed recently, usually coming from the UK. And one of these tools is a direct observation of polypectomy skills that allows us to rise or establish the levels of competence for polypectomy. And in this scale, it's a 4-point scale, and you have to achieve at least 3 points at each of these categories, like optimal polyp position and so on, to be competent in polypectomy. Therefore, we can somehow standardize the polypectomy technique as well. And all these four determinants bring us to the final goal of having or achieving the effectiveness or effective screening program. And what you can achieve if you are successful with these four determinants is that you can have more or less 60% reduction in colorectal cancer mortality if you implement colonoscopy screening, more or less 40% reduction in colorectal cancer mortality if you implement flexible sigmoidoscopy screening, and more or less 20% reduction if you implement guaiac FOBT. FIT screening, which is promising, is not here because there are no good studies about that at that time. So this brings me to the conclusion that in order to make screening for colorectal cancer more effective, you have to address all these four main determinants. You have to have interventions to promote compliance in your population. You have to choose efficacious screening tests. You have to have quality assurance and improvement initiatives in place, and you have to optimize your treatment techniques, and then you will achieve the goal. Thank you very much for your attention.